Grenade, you deserve it all. Come on, let your heart shine. No, we give you the highest praise. You deserve it all. You deserve it all. We give you the highest praise. You deserve it all. You deserve it all.
Welcome to church this morning, friends. We're going to receive communion together, but we're going to do it a little differently today. So don't sit down, but if you look under your seat, you should have one of those little cups with some juice and cracker. We're just going to stay in this spirit of worship, and I want to invite you, if you are, if you're here alone, you can receive communion anytime you want to throughout this next couple of songs. And if you're with your wife or your kids, I would encourage you, over the next 10 minutes or so, grab your spouse, grab your kids, pray together, receive it all together. And I want to pray for it now. Jesus, we remember. We remember. We remember your body, broken, when you stood up at the Last Supper and you held up the bread. And you shared with us, this represents my body broken for you. And then you held up the glass and you said, this is my blood. Pour out for you for the sins of the world. And so we remember that. We remember that today, Jesus, and we thank you for the cross. We thank you for the sacrifice. It's in Jesus' name.
Oh, wonder. Jesus, we do honor you with your liver, your sacrifice. We Seems like we're awake. We're ready to roll. Anybody know what's happening this Monday night from 6 to 8 p.m.? Some of you do. Okay, our first summer night together as a church family. Barbecue. We're having some cornhole, hamburgers, hot dogs, all that kind of stuff outside on the patio. And inside for the kiddos, we're going to be serving them pizza and having a movie night here. And so I encourage you guys to come out tomorrow night. Do not let the warm temperatures scare you away now. We've been waiting for them for a long time, and they have arrived, okay? And so we will actually have some seating for the adults next door in the community space. And so if you get hot and you want to get out of there, just bring yourselves. Food will be provided. If you have a haircut that's similar to mine, you might want to bring some sunscreen. But other than that, look forward to seeing you guys. RSVP is not required, so if you forget or if you're just not sure if you're going to make it, you can come out tomorrow night, even if you don't. But, of course, it helps us to plan in terms of food and drink and all that kind of stuff. And so last I heard yesterday, we had like 200 RSVP'd. So I think it's going to be a good turnout and a lot of fun. And if you haven't RSVP'd and you're planning to come, just go online, click attend at the top of the webpage, and then under that you'll see the box saying summer night, summer nights, and you can click that, and we will go from there. You guys probably know, of course, we're very grateful that this lease got extended for our launch pad because we didn't have anywhere else to go. So thank you, Lord, for that. But the good news is we are closer and closer to landing a landing pad, a home for our church family to be a home base of the mission of the church and all of that. And certainly we are on a timeline as time is ticking down on how long we have on this extension. Last week you probably heard that we had a letter of intent, and that became mutually signed around the middle of the week. And late Thursday night, we actually took a big step forward and we received the official contract from the seller, which is a really great thing. And so we had that out to legal review, and we're hoping and praying to have a fully executed contract by the end of the week. And so continue to pray. And if so, we will officially launch a campaign to purchase and prepare that space. In the meantime, if you would like to give to support the ministry of Church of the Front Range, of course, if you're in person, we do have offering buckets available on your way out. But you can also give online at churchofthefrontrange.com. So thank you guys for listening to that. You know, this weekend actually marks the sixth month since we launched as a church family, Church of the Front Range. I am very blown away that in 6 months, God has moved us into a position where actually purchasing a place is an option. I think it was like 6 weeks ago, I was thinking that was impossible. And I had the realization, like, shame on me, because we've been doing a series for 6 months called All Things Possible as we've been studying the book of Acts. And I'm like, well, live and learn, young man, live and learn. Well, I'm 40 now. I'm not that young. But nevertheless, if you have your Bibles with you, we're going to be continuing this series. Acts 11:19-26 is where we're going to be. As you're turning there, let me ask you, have you ever been thrown a curveball and found yourself at a dead end? Have you ever suffered a setback and heard the whisper in your ear, the end? Have you ever experienced life give you a kick in the rear end? If so, this weekend is for you. We are going to be seeing God turn a dead end into an open door in this text. We're going to see God turn a the end into a the beginning. In fact, today is all about the impossible of bringing a beginning from an end. From an end. God opens doors when there seems to be no way. That's his specialty. But we're also going to see that there are some things, and they're spelled out in this text, specific things that can get in the way of us recognizing, us walking through the open door that He is opening whenever we have just experienced doors being closed. And so what's the first thing that can get in the way? Acts 11:19 says this. It says, then those who were scattered because of the persecution that occurred in connection with Stephen, they made their way to Phoenicia, Cyprus, and Antioch, speaking the word to no one except Jews alone. Now, just to kind of orient us geographically on a map, you can see the landscape there a bit in red. That's Jerusalem circled in the bottom. That region of Phoenicia is along the coast up there to the north. Antioch is highlighted in turquoise even further north. And the island of Cyprus circled in the yellow highlighter there is even west of there. So we're just going to slow down and unpack a little bit what's going on. There's a lot of pieces in play. So the persecution with Stephen, where did that happen? Jerusalem, that's right. And again, that's in the map on the red. And then we just read that those who were scattered from Jerusalem because of the persecution that was in Jerusalem, they went where? They went to Phoenicia, they went to Antioch, and they went to Cyprus. And they did what? Speaking the word to no one except Jews alone. If that sentence seems a little unusual and a little odd, it's meant to catch your attention for a reason. The point is, they're scattered, but they are seeking out their own, even as they have been scattered. They clearly don't know about what God just showed Peter, which we looked at last week with the sheep coming down and don't call unclean what I've called clean, and going into Cornelius' house and the barrier between Jew and Gentile being broken down through what Jesus did. But do you remember what Jesus said even before he ascended back to heaven? Back in Acts 1:8, he said, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you shall be my witnesses. Where? In Jerusalem, in Judea, which is the area surrounding Jerusalem, in Samaria, which is to the north, and as far as the remotest part of the earth. Okay. This right here, them being scattered beyond Jerusalem, beyond Judea, beyond Samaria even, going into these other territories, this is the fulfillment of that prophetic promise and that commission and that command that Jesus gave. We know from last week, they don't yet recognize what Jesus has done. They don't recognize that the gospel is for everybody, Jew and Gentile, and it's for everywhere, not just for one place, but they can't see it. They can't see the new thing God's doing. They cannot see how He is advancing His purposes in this moment, how He is advancing His plans in this moment. And why can't they see it? They can't see it because the fulfillment of this prophecy is coming through so much loss. They can't see it because the fulfillment of this prophecy is coming through hurt and it's coming through persecution. Listen, believer, if we're not careful, grief blinds. Grief blinds. They can't see it. Something we got to be careful of, by the way. We get a word, we get a picture like this, and it's so promising, and we want God to say yes to the promise, but we want Him to say no to the path to that promise. And once we hit a place on the path that's kind of dark and it's a constricting tunnel and we're passing through that place, suddenly we start to suppose that we had heard wrong. We start to say, did you really say that, God? A pain-filled path to the promise does not negate the promise, believer. A problem-ridden path to the promise does not negate the promise, believer. In fact, I have yet to see an example in Scripture where God made a promise and the path to it wasn't filled with quite a bit of pain and problems, okay? So listen, if we do not recognize this, we will allow grief in our lives of unexpected and unwanted door closures to keep us from seeing the doors that God has just opened. And so think about them. They're in Jerusalem. God's been moving mightily, right? Yeah, I mean, they were grieving that Jesus had left and gone to heaven, but they've received the Spirit, and good things are happening, and they can celebrate that, and they can see the good that God is doing. Things were really still pointing in the right direction, all the way up until the persecution of Stephen. That was a turning point. It was really a pretty positive narrative up until then. The Spirit fell. The church was erupting. It was a good day to be a part of a really good thing. And then, bam, persecution broke out against them and what God was doing. Families were now getting torn apart. People were getting put in prison. The mission is seeming to suffer. They've lost their homes. They've lost their place of worship. They've lost their connections. They've lost their familiarities. The outpouring of the Spirit on the people in Jerusalem has been all but snuffed out. And now they find themselves where? Out of Israel. And if you're an Israelite in the first century, that's like being kicked out of Eden, okay? This is the promised land. They've been kicked out of their homes. They've been scattered abroad. And when this happened, these places, they can seem empty. These places can seem barren. They can seem to serve no other purpose other than to provide a place to be, to get away from the place that we were running from and flee from what had happened before. But we have to recognize something. Believer, don't you see that this place was so much more than that? This was the place Jesus had promised. The place Jesus spoke of when he said, you're going to be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. But they couldn't see the fulfillment of the promise God made because of the pain in the path to that promise. People can get real picky about which paths they will accept to God's promises. And it's really not that different of a story today. It comes in so many different forms. I mean, really, whenever people are picking apart the scriptures and just picking the parts that they find acceptable, it's really an example of this. Of course, an extreme version is what we looked at last weekend, attempting to lob off the Old Testament altogether. But then in the New Testament, you get the same thing. Some, for example, want to say yes to the parts of the New Testament that have intellectual truth. It's like, I like that, you know? But then all of this kind of the move of the Spirit in the New Testament, the speaking of the Spirit, the signs and the wonders and the miracles and all of that, they'll say, no, not that. And in the same breath, they'll say, because we just want to be people of the Word. Like, you literally just ripped out half the New Testament to say you want to be people of the Word. People of the Word who are not people of the Spirit are not people of the Word. You see what I'm saying? You can't pick and piece apart what the path to God's promises. You'll get others who say, well, I want to live and I want to experience New Testament Christianity. And what they're meaning to say is, like, I want to embrace the truth. I want to live. I want to see the stuff that God does. I want to see Him move in mighty ways. I want to be a part of miracles. But then they'll get to a passage like imprisonment or bringing or bearing shame for Jesus' name, or suffering on account of the cause and the reputation of Christ. And like, well, you know, I didn't mean that part. Surely my daddy would never want me to experience anything like that. But is that New Testament Christianity? It's like, I want the promise, but I don't want that path. No way. We have to be clear. What is New Testament Christianity? It's one with the King who has the throne, and His name is Jesus. And it's one whose subjects have such a love for Him, and they have such a loyalty to Him. They have such a gratitude toward Him that there's no cost too great. There's no price that they will not pay. They understand that there was an exchange, His life for ours, and that's the best deal ever. They know this. If God says it, they believe it, and they believe it fully, and they believe it wholly, and they believe it without exception. They don't piece and parcel it apart. And they don't hold back from speaking all of God's truth, just picking pieces and parts of God's truth, just because it's inconvenient to them. They know that God only speaks truth, and they love Him, and they love His truth, and they proclaim His truth with passion. And what else about New Testament Christianity? It's a Christianity of radical surrender. There's really nothing held back, nothing held from, nothing stored up. Everything one has spilled out at His feet for His purposes. There's no contemplation, no hesitation as to what it will give and what it won't, because it's all His. That's New Testament Christianity. It's a Christianity that seeks His presence too. It doesn't ignore His presence. It seeks His presence. It's a Christianity that's saturated in His Spirit. It's one where ministry is done by His Spirit. It's one where ministry is done in His Spirit. It's one where ministry is led by His Spirit. It is not just declaration of word. New Testament Christianity is also a demonstration of power. It's proclamation and power. And when the Spirit is present, do you know what happens? God does powerful things. The lost are saved. The lame are healed. Chains get broken. Oppression gets lifted. Hope is given. Freedom is found. It's a revolution. And God's presence is poured out. And while we're talking about picking parts and pieces, listen, New Testament Christianity is one that loves lavishly. It's a true family. It's one that does life together, loves each other, serves one another. It's not a group that comes together and fulfills a religious function. It's not one that comes and just checks some kind of religious box. It's a family that walks with one another and prays for one another and encourages one another. It's the closest of community that we've been reading about. It's the kind which cannot be reproduced and it cannot be replicated apart from His Spirit either. And I do want to encourage you, just as an aside, if this is not your experience here, I would highly encourage you to take the steps to get connected at church. You know, of course, one of the best ways, it's our heart that everyone would have a pastor and a people in a place. One of the best ways for that to happen is to join a serving team. That's a community that serves together. Another great way is to, you know, come out on Wednesday night. Join a small group on Wednesday nights. That's a fantastic way to get connected as well. Here's the point. Picking pieces and parts of New Testament Christianity is not actually New Testament Christianity, and it will not produce the results of New Testament Christianity either. New Testament Christianity, it's a give all for the one who gave all. And so it's a surrendered people, and it's a loyal people. It's a presence people, and it's a power people. It's a word people, and it's a spirit-led people. It is a loving people. It's a serving people. It's a giving people. It's a sacrificing people. It's a heaven happen here people. It's a life laid down people. It's a kingdom come here and now people. Don't ever forget that it's closed doors that open doors in God's kingdom. And He brings life through death and gain through loss and power through pressing and promises through persecution. But we will often fail to see the door that He is opening if we are blinded by grief. Verse 20 of chapter 11, let's continue forward. But there were some of them, men of Cyprus and of Cyrene, who came to Antioch, and they began speaking to the Greeks as well, preaching the good news of Jesus, of the Lord Jesus. And the hand of the Lord was with them, and a large number who believed turned to the Lord. Now, to be of Cyprus, to be of Cyrene, the significance of that, it shows us something. They did not suffer through the persecution that the Jews had suffered through in Jerusalem. And so notice what they're doing. They're heading all the way to Antioch, and they're proclaiming the gospel to the Greeks, not just to the Jews, as we read earlier, of those that were persecuted in Jerusalem were doing. And there's something significant here because we've already seen this group. They were blinded by grief. But also the second reason that we can fail to see the open door that God is opening is because we often allow a setback to cause us to shrink back. Have you ever done that? We often allow a setback to cause us to shrink the scope of what we hope for God to do in and through our lives. And so can you see it? They're actually playing it safe here. It's like, oh, we just got a real eye-opening to what the enemy can do. And Stephen, he was killed. They stoned him to death. And now all of a sudden it's like, well, you know, batten down the hatches. Lock all the doors. Let's put some deadbolts on this thing. We suffer loss. And often what we do is we want to go into safe mode. But safe will never be the aim of the Christian. So often we see this. Our greatest concern for us is not God's greatest concern for us. I'm not saying that God's not concerned for us. He is. Not that God doesn't love us. Of course He does. But God also has a mission to advance. He has purposes that last for all of eternity, and His heart is set on the fulfillment of them. But safe can become an idol that will keep us away from the place of kingdom purpose. Some obvious examples would be, you know, not going to an unreached people group because one might say, well, God, of course, would never, you know, want me to put myself at harm or at risk. But is that truly New Testament Christianity? Or maybe not speaking to a colleague about Christ because concern about the cost, concern about the loss that could come. And saying, well, God would want me to play it safe, wouldn't He? Surely He would. Or maybe people withholding from giving, confident God would want them to play it safe financially. But is that actually biblical Christianity? American Christianity has actually really fallen in love with this idol of safety I believe. So much so that the word wisdom now has been redefined to mean playing it safe. Wisdom has been redefined to mean without risk. Many who are called wise today, they're just safety and security experts. We used to call them cowards. Now we call them wise, okay? Listen, God didn't design you with safety in mind. God didn't plan your life with security in mind. He made you with His mission in mind. He made you with His purpose in His mind. I love that we celebrate soldiers going to war for our country, going and serving on the front lines of battle for our country, even being willing to go behind enemy lines for our country and for our safety and for our freedom and all of that, as we certainly should. But I think it's so strange that in one breath we can prize that so much, and then in the next we can consider Christianity a soldierless, play-it-safe cause. But every citizen in the kingdom of heaven is a soldier in the kingdom of heaven. And we need to remember something, that anything we lose in this battle for the cause of His kingdom, we gain back in this life, oftentimes, and definitely in eternity, 100-fold and more. In fact, in the kingdom of God, the more we lose for His kingdom, the more we gain. Let's not forget, church, what is the commendation that believers receive whenever they stand before the Lord at the last day? Is it, "Well done, you've arrived safely"? Well done, you've arrived securely. There's no bruise, there's no bangs. Wow, can all of heaven kind of stand up and give a clap here? Is that how this goes? That's not what we read about. Is it, "Well done, you have arrived with storehouses of earthly treasures"? Way to go. No, it's, "Well done, good and faithful slave." To be very accurate to the Greek, it's what he says. You see, those persecuted and scattered, what they thought was demotion, it was promotion. What they thought was loss, it was actually gain. What they thought was setback, it was a set up. Believer, have the heart and have the eyes to see what God is doing. Be on guard against grief, blinding, and setbacks leading to shrinkbacks in your life. They prevent us from seeing what He is doing. Continuing on to verse 21, "And the hand of the Lord was with them," meaning those that came from Cyrene all the way over to Antioch, "and a large number of the Gentiles believed and turned to the Lord." And so I do just want to stop and say, when it says the hand of the Lord was with them, the hand of the Lord, that's what we need. And that is what we plead. Because do you know what happens by the hand of God? What can happen by no other hand? I mean, when Jesus extended His hand, a man was healed of leprosy. When Jesus extended His hand, a fever fled. When Jesus extended His hand, the dead girl rose from her bed. When Jesus extended His hand, a withered hand was made extended. When Jesus extended His hand, deaf ears were opened. A mute tongue was unleashed. When Jesus extended His hand, blind eyes became seeing eyes. When Jesus extended His hand, the oppressed and thrown into the fire child became a snatched from the fire and freed son. That means God was with them, that His power was with them. And let it be written of us that the hand of God was with them. Amen? That the hand of the Lord was with them, and it meant a large number believed and turned to the Lord. Let it be written of us. That the hand of the Lord was with them, and it meant a reviving of what was dying inside of God's people, a passion in place of complacency. Let it be written of us. Amen? That the hand of the Lord was with them, and it meant a reclaiming of what was lost in the church, power in place of impotence. Let it be written of us. Amen. I mean, what can we do without Him? What can we do without His power pulsating through us all throughout God's history? God's people have been a people of His presence and a people of His power. And what's the path to His power? It's purity and it's humility. I always remember, because false humility is a thing, you know? Humility's number one trait is dependency. It's saying, "God, I can't, but I know You can. I need You. And so I'm humbling myself, and I'm seeking You. And I'm asking You to do what only You can do, knowing that I can't do it." Humility bows because it knows it needs. Pride does not know it needs. It operates in self-sufficiency. Let us be a people to humble ourselves that His power can be at work. I do want to commend you as a church, the way that you have come so dependently in prayer since inception, but over the last 3 weeks, there's just been a remarkable increase in the commitment to prayer. I think we're approaching something like 600 hours of prayer over the last couple of weeks, unbroken intercession 24/7 for 3 weeks now in a row, with the exception of some slots last Thursday. I think there might have been a game on or something. I'm not sure what happened there. But I want to say, way to go, church. Okay? And have you noticed the increase in the Spirit that's been taking place at the same time? It's not accidental. God responds to the prayers of His people. And I really feel like, yes, we're still praying for finality and closure and all this stuff and a home base and all that. But it would be short-sighted to stop or slow down now. God is building up a house of prayer in this church. Jesus, of course, said, "My house shall be called a house of prayer." I just hear God say, not only this house, my house will be a house of prayer. And so I want to encourage you to go to battle in this way. And if you've never done that before, it's easy to sign up. You just click pray on the website, and you can choose a slot. At some point during the week, you'll receive a prayer guide, and you can pray from there. God says, not by might or by power, but by my Spirit. He also says, unless the Lord builds it, the laborers labor in vain. So here's the thing. Do we have programs and paradigms and practices and principles and all that kind of stuff? Yes, absolutely. It's not that there's anything wrong with these. We just have to understand their limitations. They're limited in what they can do. None of them can snatch someone out of the fire of hell. Only the power of God can do that. None of those things can set the oppressed free. Only the power of God can do that. None of them can heal, bring wholeness, hope. Only the power of God can do that. There's no substitution for the power of God. Oh, and does humanity try? We try as we may, we try as we might, but there's no substitution. And so we always want to remember, what kind of vessel can house this power? It's only a humble one. It's only a simple one, one that's empty of other ambition, and it's freely and fully given to Him. And so I do want to encourage you, just there's someone here, I believe, that needs encouragement. So if you're here and you're the one who thinks that you're too simple to be used by God in a mighty way, or not stand out, or not special, or maybe you think that you just don't have that much to offer. Maybe you're someone who thinks that you just don't have that much to bring, or maybe you think you're too old, or maybe you think you're too young. Maybe you think that you're not smart enough, or that you don't know enough. Do you know what type of vessel He uses? It is not the one that showcases the bling of their abilities before Him. It says, God, look at all that I could do for you. It's not someone who flaunts their qualifications. It's one that comes as an empty, simple vessel and says, God, anything I do have has been given by your hand. And I may not have much. I may not seem to be much, but I'm yours. Fill me. Use me for your purposes. Do you know the heart of God, church? Do you know how much joy is brought to the heart of God when one of His sons, one of His daughters comes and prays a simple prayer like that? And you know what God does in response to that? The hand of God picks up the humble and set apart vessel for His purposes. And He also opens doors for them that none can shut. And so let's look back. Let's look at the third thing. The third thing that gets in the way of seeing God, God's beginning, from a so-called end, Acts 11:22. The news about them, meaning what God was doing in Antioch amongst the Gentiles and all that, well, it reached the ears of the church in Jerusalem, and they sent Barnabas off to Antioch. So the church in Jerusalem, they hear about this. Now, what had happened just before this? Peter had come, and he had had that vision, and then he had been told to go to Cornelius' house, the Roman centurion, and he went in there, and it was like a Gentile party in there, and Peter was uncomfortable, but God told him to, and then he preached the message God told him to give, and the Spirit fell on them, just as it did on the Jewish believers back in Acts chapter 2. And he told them all about that, and they had just come to this conclusion, the verse before where we started, verse 18 of chapter 11. When they heard this, they quieted down, and they glorified God, saying, well, then God has granted to the Gentiles also the repentance that leads to life. And so what does this show us? It shows us that this is new revelation to them, to the church in Jerusalem. They saw this as really something God was about to do, but it was actually something God was already doing. In believers who were in Africa and Cyrene, okay, they were already doing this. And this is important. They're just now becoming aware of it. We have to remember that we have a global God who is on the move, and he is at work at all times. So never assume that it's only going to happen here if it's going to happen at all, or that it's going to happen here first if God is doing some incredible thing. With Western Christianity, I really believe that many stop believing in the powerful and miraculous things that God does simply because they were unwilling to hear the reports from around the world. It's like, well, it's not happening here, so it doesn't happen. Or if it was happening somewhere, surely we would know about it. But let's not assume that. I'll never forget spending some time main speaker for a huge Christian conference that was being telecast all over the world. And I shared with him that I had this house guest from India. He was a pastor in India, and he was sharing these pictures and these stories of this incredible work of God. He just had these pictures of throngs of people coming and getting baptized, and he was sharing this the sign and wonder that had happened that had led to this mass conversion, and I was just like in awe of it, and I remember sharing it with this guy in excitement, and he said, well, if that's true, he should be the speaker and not me, and he really just laughed and totally dismissed it, and it kind of stuck with me like, okay, we want to be those who hear the new, even unbelievable, impossible thing that God is doing. We want to meet it with desiring, not with dismissing. In this instance, they received that report in Jerusalem about what was happening, and then they responded to the report. Even though there's not many resources left in Jerusalem. You know, they got the apostles, they have a few people around, they're very limited. They still send Barnabas all the way up there to them, and so we don't want to miss this. We want to be a part of what God's doing. They didn't want to miss it, and that's the third step to seeing the door that God is opening. It's actually desire. It's desiring to be a part of what he is doing and to do what he is wanting to do. We can often be so undesiring because we get so tight-fisted with the way we knew things to be or the way that we're used to things being. It's like, well, I don't want to be here, and this isn't an assignment that I asked for, you know. But you have to remember that they had always understood things one way. They had always understood the promise of the land, okay? And so they're seeing being pushed out of Jerusalem and pushed out of Israel as a loss of the promise. They cannot see this is actually an expansion of the promise. They can't see the greater gain. They cannot see the increase, that it's no longer one strip of Palestinian soil, but it's to the ends of the earth. They can't see it. Just as an aside, whenever you're praying about an open door and you cannot see what God is doing and what he is leading you toward, if you're having trouble hearing, I found a good practice is to stop and say, God, is there something that I am unwilling to hear or unwilling to let go of? And then listen. And I find often the speaking picks back up, and then the phrase that I found to be helpful is to respond to the Lord with saying, okay, I don't want to, but I will. But of course, I want my heart to change to want what you want, but that doesn't often come immediately. I don't want to, but I will. When our desires are surrendered, he's not having to contend with what we want and what we're blocking off in his speaking, and our eyes can be open to see what he is doing. And so in this case, we're seeing this embrace of this new thing from those in Jerusalem and in Barnabas. We're seeing them embrace it in a profound way. If he was holding tightly to what he had and what he would have known, that would not have allowed this to happen. Acts 11:23. Then when Barnabas arrived and he witnessed the grace of God, what was happening in Antioch, he rejoiced and he began to encourage them all with resolute heart to remain true to the Lord. So he hears this testimony from Peter about God moving among the Gentiles, and now he gets an opportunity to go, and he goes, and he actually sees it with his own eyes, and just right away he rejoices. So he hears the testimony, he desires it in his heart. I presume he was praying and longing. God answers his prayer and sends him, and then he's rejoicing at what he sees. Those who see God do what only he can do. Those who see God open doors when everything has been a closed door. Those who see God do the things that are impossible are those that long for the things of God. They seek the things of God, and they pray for the things of God. And this is what we see in Barnabas here. And then what do they do then? Verse 24 to 26 to wrap it up. For he was a good man, full of the Holy Spirit and faith. And considerable numbers were added to the Lord. And he left for Tarsus to look for Saul, who's also the Apostle Paul. And when he had found him, he brought him to Antioch. And for an entire year, they met with the church and taught considerable numbers of people. And the disciples were first called Christians at Antioch. Okay, they were first called Christians at Antioch. So a reminder, Barnabas, he's the one that took Saul in Jerusalem after he had become a believer. And he traveled down to Jerusalem, and the Jewish believers were like, oh, he's the murderer. You know, we don't want him around. And he said, no, listen, this is how God met him, and here's how God spoke to him powerfully and all that kind of stuff in Damascus. And then Paul began to preach in Jerusalem, and they were about to do to him what they had done to Stephen. And so they sent Saul off, also named Paul off, to protect him. But now Barnabas, he goes up to Antioch. God's pouring out his spirit on the Gentiles. And then he leaves there to go up to Tarsus to find Saul. And when he finds him, he brings him back to Antioch. And they spend a whole year there doing ministry. Now, do we see what's happening here? Back in verse 19, we were told that it was those that were persecuted in Jerusalem at Stephen's stoning. They were the ones that were scattered up to Antioch. And who was the one there that was holding the coats for all the stone throwers and leading the way in the persecution that came on Stephen? Saul. And of all people, Barnabas goes to get who to bring him back to Antioch? Saul. Why? Because God is in the redemption business. That's why. And then what happens? They were first called Christians at Antioch. What the enemy was calling the end. It's over. God says, no. That was the prologue, and now here's page one of the new thing that I am doing throughout the rest of history called Christianity, okay? Just listen to God next time you're hearing someone say the end after a painful door closing in your life. God says, I don't write stories. I don't write stories that way. With God, a dead end is a door opened. At the end is a place for chapter one to begin. And there's no doubt that they were saying, God abandoned us, while God was saying, I have not abandoned you. I am positioning you. So I'm just going to invite us to bow our heads and close our eyes as we respond today. And as we do, to some of you that are here, maybe you're watching online, and you're at one of those places. It just appears to be a dead end. And you're struggling to see how God can or how he is opening a door in the midst of a seeming dead end. I want you to remember that our God is the God for whom all things are possible. There is nothing that our God cannot do. And that what the scriptures testify about him is true. That he opens doors that no man can shut. And he shuts doors that no man can open. And if you hear someone whispering in your ear, you're defeated. This is a dead end. Just know that's the end. God saying, I don't end stories that way. And so to respond to this message, some of you, you're in a place of discouragement where you are struggling to believe that a door can be opened or that a door will be opened in a moment. I'm going to pray for those of you who are feeling that. And if that's you, with heads bowed and eyes closed, would you just raise your hands and know who I'm praying for. Thank you, God. Okay. Put your hands down. There's others of you in this room. You may not be having trouble believing that God is going to open a door, but you're kind of realizing that you might be having trouble seeing the door. And maybe it's because of one of those three reasons. Maybe it's because of grief blinding. Maybe it's just shrinking back in safety and scope after what happened. Maybe it's about desire. I would just encourage you, if you think that's you, just to say, God, when it comes to seeing what you're doing in my life, is there any unprocessed grief that's blinding me from seeing? If so, would you reveal that, God? Would you move in my heart to heal? For God, is it true of me that I kind of accepted a shrinking of scope because of a setback that I've suffered? Have I been playing it safe, unwilling to step out into what you're calling me to because of a drive for safety? Saying no to you over the things that you're praying through all of that, church. I also just want to speak to another group of you. Some of you are listening online, some of you in this room. If you're here, you're listening, and you just kind of know in your soul, like, not everything is well with me, thank God. You know it, you sense it. It could be for a number of reasons. Maybe you're here, you're watching, and you're just honestly carrying the weight of sin. It just feels like 100 pounds in your chest. From the time you wake up to the time you go to bed, it's like you can't even just catch a deep breath. And for you, it's like you know what you've done. You're ashamed of what you've done, and you are convinced that God can't or that He will not forgive what you've done. For one person, it just sends through prayer that it's tied to a relationship that you have persisted in and that you know that you shouldn't be in. I just want you to know, listen, God is willing to forgive. And instantly turn to Him. Your step today is just to stop running away towards sin and just turn toward Him. The second group of you, that all is not well, it's because of anger. You're angry at God. You believe that He's been unjust with you. Concerned about what you're suffering through. In prayer before the weekend, also, since there's one of you in this group, that there was a loss that came through a car accident, and you have attributed that to Him directly. For those in this group, I want you to know God's not against you. He loves you. He's not the author of evil. His eyes have always been on you. His heart has always been filled with love for you. He is reaching out to you today. Would you take His hand? Third group, you may kind of know about God from your childhood days. You may be here for the first time. But either way, you don't have a relationship with Him. Not a real relationship where you go to Him. You're hoping that your sin will be forgiven. You're hoping that you will spend eternity with God, but you're fearful whenever it comes to the future. And you cannot definitely say, I will spend eternity with God and not apart from Him. Listen, if that's you, to any of those I just described, if you're carrying the weight of unforgiven sin, or you feel like there's a wall of anger between you and God, or not knowing Him, you're lacking assurance of forgiveness of sin. Listen, you don't need to leave the same way that you came today. God lifts the weights of sin and shame when we turn to Him. God overcomes chasms of separation when we turn to Him. God forgives sin. He brings us into a relationship with Him when we turn to Him. The Bible is clear that there is a chasm. It is of inestimable size between everyone who sinned, which is all of us, and our God, who is perfect, who is holy, who is without sin. And we cannot span this chasm. No amount of good deeds can span this chasm. So while we were helpless, God spanned the chasm. He did what we could not do. He made a way for our sin to be forgiven, that we could be reconciled into relationship with the Holy God. How did He do that? Jesus, who is God, He came and He died for sin. Not His sin, ours. And then He rose on the third day. And He's made salvation available to all, but it's only accepted by some. And it's accepted when we personally place our faith in Jesus Christ for who He is, for what He has done. When we come and we say, I believe that You, Jesus, being God, You came, You died for my sin, and You rose again so that I could be forgiven. Receive life forever in relationship with You. The moment we do that, we're forgiven of our sin. We are brought into a relationship with God starting right away, and we are rescued from spending eternity apart from Him to spending eternity with Him. Acts 4:12 says there's salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven that has been given among mankind by which we must be saved. is no other way. There is no other name. There is no other path to peace with God and forgiveness from Him. Only Jesus. Only Jesus. So if you're here and you want to be forgiven of the sin that separated you from God, including the sin that you thought couldn't be forgiven, if you're here and you want to bring down the walls of anger and resentment that have stood between you and Him and enter into a relationship with Him, where you know Him and you're known by Him, you want to say yes to an eternity with Him, first apart from Him by placing your faith, your trust, your hope, and your belief in Jesus Christ. And with heads bowed and eyes closed, I'm going to invite you to raise your hand as your way of saying to Him, God, that's me. I want to say yes to you today. For those listening online, there's a place for you to indicate that you want to receive what Jesus has made available to you as well. And if that's you, I just want to lead you in a prayer to come and say, God, I want to know you. I want to have a relationship with you, and I believe, Jesus, that you came and you died and you rose so that I could be forgiven, so that I could receive eternal life, which is a relationship with you. And I'm asking you to do that for me today. Would you please forgive me of my sin? Would you give me a gift of knowing you starting today? God, I also want to pray. We want to pray as a church family for those that are feeling discouraged, for those that are having difficulty believing that you can, that you will open a door, that you'll make a way, that you have not declared the end on the story to the point that they're at. God, we pray for your power by your power. To lift off the voice and the weight of discouragement, of hopelessness, and we're praying that your Spirit would fill your sons and fill your daughters with compassion. God, we're praying that you would begin to illuminate the redemption path, the restoration path, the door that you're opening to participate your purposes. And we pray for this in Jesus' powerful name and all who agree to say. Amen, amen. Thank you guys for coming out today. It's awesome to be with you. Don't forget, tomorrow night, 6 p.m., we'll be having barbecue and pizza inside for the kids. And if you're here and you need prayer, if you're seeking prayer, maybe you need physical healing or spiritual or emotional